أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم Inshallah, today we'll talk about the second half of Surat Al-Maidah, which is chapter 5. Just to recap, we said that the last time the theme of Surat Al-Maidah is in the first verse. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ All you who believe, fulfill your contracts. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala lists many contracts in the surah, and He expects us to uphold these contracts. So we said the first contract was about lawful food, that eat halal food, do not eat the bad. And he listed what we can eat and what we cannot eat. The second contract was lawful wives, not to go through marriage, not to go through any other channel. The third contract was spiritual goodness, talked about wudu and making tayammum and this purity, the physical, purity and, being ready for prayers and such. And then the fourth contract was to uphold justice. And, justice is the implementation of haqq, of the truth. So we have to, it's an order from Allah that we have to implement justice regardless of who is on the other side, whether it's a relative or a non-relative. So, and then we talked about a couple of examples of Allah mentioned the children of Israel and how they broke their covenant, and about the Christians and how they broke their covenant after Allah revealed all that stuff to them. And then there was an example of Qabil and Habil, the two sons of Adam. One fulfilled the covenant by not wanting to hurt his brother, and the second brother, he did not care about the covenant and he killed his own brother and suffered, will suffer for eternity for it. So these were examples that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala gave us of people who, failed in their covenant. So inshallah, today we'll talk about the additional contracts and the rest of the surah. Contract number 5 is piety and striving in the way of Allah. That's a contract that we have with Allah to do our best to support his deen and, to get close to him. In verse 35, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَابْتَغُوا إِلَيْهِ الْوَسِيلَةَ وَجَاهِدُوا فِي سَبِيلِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ O you have believed, fear Allah and seek the means of nearness to Him and strive in His cause that you may succeed. So this is, and the best way to keep our contract with Allah is to get closer to Him, because then He'll help us fulfill those contracts. And then in verse 51, there's another contract that if you have to have allegiance, your allegiance is only to a fellow believer. Your allegiances cannot be to anybody other than a believer. And this is in verse 51. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَى أَوْلِيَاءَ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ وَمَا يَتَوَلَّهُم مِّنكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِّنْهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ O you have believed, do not take the Jews and the Christians as allies. Now, this verse is not talking badly about Jews and Christians. It's talking about we as Muslims have our own identity, have our own rules to uphold, and we can, we have to rely on ourselves, on each other. We cannot be relying on other people that may or may not, want to support us. So do not take them as allies. They are, in fact, allies of one another. And this concept is very big. I mean, that's for another day. But, I mean, the awliya is very close friends. I mean, they're the first people to run to. That should be a fellow Muslim. That the first, because if something good happens to you, they'll be happy for you. But if you go in and take an awli, somebody who's not of your faith, He may be pretending to support you, but he may not. So Allah is saying, your allegiance should be only to fellow believers. The seventh contract is a threat of replacement, that if we do not uphold our covenant with Allah, Allah will replace us. In verse 54, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَا يَرْتَدَّ مِنْكُمْ عَنْ دِينِهِ فَسَوْفَ يَأْتِي اللَّهُ بِقَوْمٍ يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَهُ أَذِلَّةٍ عَلِى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَعِزَّةٍ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ يُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلَا يَخَافُونَ لَوْمَةَ لَائِمٍ ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. O you have believed, whoever of you should revert from his religion, Allah will bring forth as a punishment, Allah will bring forth in to replace them a people that He will love, He will love, and whom they will love Him back. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, out of His generosity and bounty, He started with His love first. That says the replacements, He would love them first, and they would, you know, they would love, you know, they would love Him back. They are humble towards the believers, powerful against the disbelievers, and all of these are measures that we have to, you know, when Allah gives us additional descriptions, they're a goal for us to strive to and a measure to measure our behavior. So these people that Allah will love and they will love Him, their qualities is they're humble towards the believers, powerful against the disbelievers. That means among each other, they're very soft and gentle, but towards the enemy, they're lions. They strive in the cause of Allah and do not fear the blame of a critic. They don't care what the rest of the world says. If you're on haqq, that's the only thing you care about. You don't care if people are you know, calling you a terrorist or calling you whatever name they want to call you. As long as you're implementing haqq, that's all you care. That these people only care what Allah says do. And, you know, they don't, you know, they don't fear the blame of a critic. This is the favor of Allah. He bestows it upon whom He wills. And Allah is all-encompassing and knowing. So these are qualities that of the people that Allah loves. And we should have that statement, that verse, as a goal and a measure. That's a goal to live up to and a measure to measure our own behavior. The next contract is social purity. It talked about avoiding alcohol and avoiding gambling and sacrificing on the stones of altars for other than Allah. So all of these are social impurities that Allah wants us to stay away from. And this is in verse 90. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسُرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. So all of these, you know, social vices are bad. And our contract with Allah says we will stay away from that. And it's the mercy of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that in verse 101, you know, 101, He knew that in our zealotness to implement these contracts, we can go overboard. So He said in verse 101, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَلُوا لَا تَسْأَلُوا عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ إِن تُبْدَ لَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ. Don't ask about things that if Allah showed it to you, I mean, it will distress you. The earlier in the surah, Allah says the faith is complete. The deen is complete. There is nothing missing. Anything that's of interest to us, Allah has made clear. So if Allah did not mention it, you know, positively or negatively, the assumption is it's allowable. So don't make it hard on yourself and go in and try to see, well, is this halal? Is this haram? The halal and haram are clear. Don't make it hard on yourself by asking too many questions about things that Allah did not mention anything about. So that's out of Allah's mercy with us. So if it's of importance, He mentioned it. If He did not mention it, we can take it or leave it. And then the second part in verse 105 says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا اهْتَدَيْتُمْ. O you have believed, upon you is the responsibility for yourselves. You're responsible for your own self and your family. You don't care about others. It's not of your concern if others believe or don't believe. Our job is to convey the message. Allah is the one who guides. You know, if He wants to guide someone, Allah brings the guidance. So our job is to convey the message, and the results are up to Allah. So we shouldn't, you know, we shouldn't overstay our responsibility. Our responsibility is only to convey the message. It's not my job to guide somebody else. That's Allah's job. All I can do is say, here's the faith, and here's the you know, the hujja and the burhan and all this stuff. And it's up to the person to accept, and the hidayah comes from Allah. And if the entire world breaks their covenant, we should not. If you're the only person in your community that's towing the straight line, tow that line. Don't go with everyone else. So we have to, you know, we're responsible for ourselves and the people in our circle. Your wife, your kids, your immediate responsibility. So this is a great guideline from Allah for us to stay firm on His covenant. In verse 33 and 38, Allah talked about implementing prescribed punishments, like the thieves, you cut their hand, all that, you know, all this stuff is in there. And these are contracts from Allah to preserve the society. So, and sometimes when you argue with non-believers and they think that cutting the hands of a thief is something very harsh. Well, I mean, it's the idea is not the punishment. The idea is the deterrence. If they knew that that's the punishment, nobody in their right mind would commit the crime. So, you know, plus these, Allah, the most merciful. I mean, man tries to come up with laws to be merciful. You're not going to be more merciful than the all-merciful. And if Allah says a murderer is killed, a thief, you cut their hands. And I mean, there are other rules that have to be in place before that is applied. But if the most merciful is saying that's what you do, that's out of the mercy of Allah with the society and with everyone. And when in our arrogance, when we try to come up with laws to be more merciful than Allah, then you see what happens in the society. Then punishment becomes not a deterrence anymore, and we see what's happening around us. People kill left and right. They'll kill you for $5. Human life has no meaning. So this is part of our contract with Allah to preserve the community. Another contract is to stand witness. Verse 106 talks about if somebody is dying and then you have, you know, there are two witnesses to witness the what their last will and testament is. You know, you're supposed, if you were there as a witness, you should serve as a witness. But so that is one of the contracts with Allah is if we are asked to give a truthful witness, you should offer it. You shouldn't just say it's none of my business. You know, be a good witness and speak the truth. Now, if we notice Sharia, you know, the Sharia in its core has five goals. It has, you know, the first goal is to preserve the faith. You know, that's the, you know, all the laws in the Sharia is to preserve the faith, which is through Tawheed. The second one is protection of the mind. You know, it wants to protect the mind, and that's where the prohibition of alcohol and things like that. The preservation of wealth. You know, your wealth is very sacred, so that's why the punishment for the thieves and so on. And then the protection of the self, which is, you know, the punishment for the murderer, and the protection of honor, which is in the prohibition of alcohol and gambling. So this surah has all the basics of Sharia in it, because that's what Sharia is. Sharia is there to protect us and make us live an honorable and good life according to Allah's instructions. So this surah deals with all of these, you know, five goals. And if we implement them, then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala will help us fulfill our covenant. Now, the surah ends in a beautiful, you know, beautiful way. In verse 109, يَوْمَ يَجْمَعُ اللَّهُ الرُّسُلَ فَيَقُولُ مَاذَا أُجِبْتُمْ قَالُوا لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. Be warned of the day when Allah will assemble the messengers and say, that's on the day of judgment, and say, what was the response you received from your people? They will say, we have no knowledge. Indeed, it is you who is knower of the unseen. So the results of whether we uphold our covenant with Allah or not will be on full display on the day of judgment. And in verse 119, and then, you know, the verses go with the conversation between Allah and Prophet Isa. And it ends with verse 119. قال الله هذا يوم يوم ينفع الصادقين صدقهم لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها أبدا رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه ذلك الفوز العظيم. Now, this is on that day, the truthful people will be the ones that have fulfilled their covenant in this life, and they have that to show for on that day. And they, you know, they say the truth as, yes, Allah, we fulfilled our covenant, and they were truthful about it. And the reward is you know, immense. And the last verse, verse 120, لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا فِيهِنْ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. To Allah belongs the dominion of the heavens and the earth and whatever is within them, and He is over all things competent. Now this is a direct reply to the first verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَوْفُوا بِالْعُقُودِ. And the last verse, it says, to Allah belongs everything and everything returns to Him. So He's going to know if we have fulfilled the covenant or if we didn't, or if we fell short, and what our intention was. And to Allah belongs everything and everything returns to Him. So we should remember that when, you know, if we ever think that of breaking the covenant, that Allah knows and everything belongs to Him and everything returns to Him. So He's going to know whether we fulfill our covenant or not. Now the last part of this the surah is why was it named Surah Al-Maidah? Now Maidah is a like a spread, is a dinner table, you know, table full of food. Now this is in reference to the story of the disciples of Prophet Isa alayhi salam. They asked Prophet Isa. They said, can your Lord bring down, then this is in the last verses of the surah, can your Lord bring down a table spread for us? And he was asking, why, you don't believe? They want it to be, you know, so that their heart will be more at ease, and they wanted to eat from it and make it as a celebration for them. So in verse 114, Isa alayhi salam, he asks Allah, قال عيسى بن مريم اللهم ربنا انزل علينا مائدة من السماء تكون لنا عيدا لأولنا وآخرنا وآية منك وارزقنا وأنت خير الرازقين. Now Al-Ma'idah is mentioned in that verse, in verse 114. Said Jesus, the son of Mary, O Allah, our Lord, send down to us a table spread with food from the heaven to be for us as a festival for the first of us and the last of us and a sign from you, and provide for us, and you are the best of providers. So Allah says, yes, you want that? I'm going to bring it down for you on one condition. And that condition is in the next verse, in verse 115. قال الله إني منزلها عليكم فمن يكفر بعد منكم فإني أعذبه عذابا لا أعذبه أحدا من العالمين. Allah said, indeed, I will send it down to you. But whoever disbelieved afterwards from among you, then indeed will I punish him with a punishment by which I have not punished anyone among the worlds. That means they will have the most severe punishment. When Allah sends you a clear sign and you break the law, then Allah's punishment is most severe. Because if you didn't know and you broke the law, that's one thing. But when you know and the signs are right in front of you, and you still choose to ignore them, then the punishment is much more severe. So the disciples were given the table, but if they disbelieved after that, their punishment would have been the most severe. And similarly, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala gave us the perfect religion. We have the Quran in front of us, which is perfect, Allah's words in front of us, and this is an ayah till the day of judgment. Similarly, if we do not believe in what's in it and we break our covenant with Allah, then Allah will punish us like He would not punish anybody else. So that's the similarity. It's not about the table. It's about the sign from Allah. That when Allah gives you a clear sign and you break it, that's why Thamud and Saleh and stuff, they ask for a miracle. Allah gave them the miracle and they still not believe. So they were destroyed. And it's the mercy of Allah that He did not, you know, when the Arabs were asking for angels to come down and all these miracles, had He sent down the miracles and they would not believe, He would have destroyed all of them. So the reference of the table spread is a reminder to us that do not break the covenant with Allah, because what He gave us, the proof that He gave us, is a clear sign from Him, as you know, it's haqq and it's what we're supposed, you know, it's from Him and we're supposed to follow it. And if we disbelieve in it, we're going to have a very bad punishment. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وينفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه واجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فاتبعون احسنه وادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك السلام عليكم ورحمه الله